Welcome to Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore. Our goal is to bring evidence and experience to illuminate critical public health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. Today, Stephanie Desmond welcomes back Johns Hopkins virologist Dr. Andy Pekosz. They discuss why COVID's Omicron variant keeps mutating, what this means in the race to end the pandemic, and how a new kind of vaccine this fall may offer better protection. Let's listen.
Andy Pekosz, thanks so much for joining me.
Oh, always a pleasure.
So today I want to talk about COVID and its variants, and I guess its subvariants, which is what we're dealing with now. So we keep calling this Omicron, these new subvariants, and they're very different from one another. Talk to me about where we sit today.
Yeah, so when Omicron first emerged, right from the beginning, we knew there were a couple of different versions of it. And as viruses do, when a variant emerges, it never stops mutating and changing. So they've continued to change. Omicron being a really transmissible virus, it just amplifies then how quickly we see these mutations emerge. And so we went from one Omicron to now there's essentially five versions of Omicron with a few other tweaks in there as well. And you know, what's important is that each of these are showing a little bit of a different property. They're different from each other. Some of my scientist friends who are really into evolution say that's what we're calling Omicron now is equivalent to what we call different variants earlier in the pandemic. So there's a lot of diversity in Omicron that's out there right now that is contributing to some issues with respect to vaccine efficacy and even treatments that are available for COVID-19.
And so what does that mean to lay folks like myself?
Well, number one, all these Omicron variants are good at evading some portion of the vaccine-induced immunity. So vaccines are still protecting against severe disease, but you should expect to, even if you're vaccinated, if you're exposed, you should probably expect to have a symptomatic infection. That's one of the things I think we're seeing a boost of. We're seeing case numbers go up, but we're not seeing hospitalizations, disease severity, or death go up at anywhere close to that same rate. So vaccines are working against severe disease, not against infection. And I think if you're, the other thing that's important is if you're eligible for some of the monoclonal antibody treatments, these different variants of Omicron have different susceptibilities to different treatments. So it really becomes a little bit tricky to figure out which treatment you can take, because it's really going to be dependent on what variant you're infected with. And we don't have the capability to very quickly tell someone you're infected with BA4 or you're infected with BA2. Yet the treatment is going to be, the efficacy of the treatment is completely dependent upon which variant you're being infected with.
Mm-hmm. It feels sort of more than ever through this whole thing that personally, I know more people with COVID right now than I have at any other point. Why is this still happening the way it is? Is it because these new variants are making it easier to become reinfected?
Yeah, I think that's the first and foremost thing, is these variants, these family of Omicrons, transmit more effectively than any other variant we've seen so far, and they evade a large portion of the vaccine-induced immunity so that you can get infected. But again, you're protected from the severe disease. So that's really, Omicron was a complete game changer when it emerged because it was so different from other variants and had such different properties that it's really pushed the whole COVID-19 pandemic into a completely different sort of area that we're now dealing with that is perhaps a little bit more similar to what we deal with seasonal influenza, where, you know, we're really now completely focused on making sure that we're doing enough to protect the vulnerable parts of the population. But the rest of us, healthy, relatively healthy individuals, are going to use vaccines to just try to limit spread, but it's not going to be protecting us from infection as well as we hoped when the vaccines were initially rolled out.
Mm-hmm. Why is this evolving so quickly? I understand that viruses evolve. We see this every year with seasonal flu. We have to get different variants out of the way. But tell me, why is this happening so quickly before our eyes?
Yeah, this is something that's really, really important area of research for a lot of virologists like myself. You know, with seasonal flu, we see like one or two mutations occur that changes the virus that makes us update vaccines, but it's kind of steady, at a steady rate. What we see with SARS-CoV-2 is these variants emerge with lots of mutations. They're like big leaps instead of small steps. And we really don't understand where this happens. There's a lot of theories out there. Some theories suggest that people who have slightly compromised immune systems are maybe generating some of these variants over time. There are a couple of other theories out there too, but it's very clear that SARS-CoV-2 is making leaps when it changes. It's not moving in these little small steps. And understanding that is going to be a really critical thing for us to really get a sense of how we can tune our strategies to make sure that we're being as effective as possible in terms of limiting SARS-CoV spread and evolution in the future.
Would a virus that doesn't mutate like this, would it be gone by now?
It would be present at a very, very low level, because if a virus can't evade immune responses, then the number of people that are susceptible to it shrinks and gets smaller and smaller each year. And oftentimes, the virus then becomes focused on either younger populations who haven't been exposed, or oftentimes older populations whose immunity is sort of waning and they can't respond as quickly to an infection. So we're not seeing that with SARS-CoV-2 right now. We're seeing that the virus is changing and still infecting healthy individuals. And understanding why that's happening is really going to be critical for us to see what is it that we're going to be dealing with COVID-19 as an annual disease going forward.
I want to talk about new vaccines that are coming. I mean, Omicron seems like almost an entirely different disease than Delta. And are we going to be getting more Omicron-specific vaccines coming soon?
Yeah, that looks like that's what's going to be happening come the fall this year. There's been some good data that's been published by Moderna and by Pfizer showing that new formulations that combine Omicron with other variants can actually give you a broader immune response that recognizes Omicron much more efficiently, but also recognizes older variants. And that's really important because with Omicron being so different from older variants, you want a vaccine that covers both bases. Because if you get too specific to Omicron, you run the risk of having the virus change and having another variant emerge. So these are called bivalent vaccines. And while they haven't been approved yet by the FDA, there certainly is a lot of good data out there suggesting that come the fall, these bivalent vaccines are going to be the ones that are recommended for at least the vulnerable parts of the population and probably for virtually everybody as a booster.
So I haven't gotten my second booster because I'm not eligible yet. But does that mean I should hold out perhaps for this new variation in September? New formulation in September.
Yeah, it's always important to balance risk with the potential benefit. I think if you're getting close to the fall right now, it's good to wait for these bivalent vaccines because they have the potential to have greater protection against infection as well as against severe disease. But certainly, I think if you're in a high-risk population, so if you're, let's say, over 70 and you're on immunosuppressive therapies, right? Those are probably populations that you wouldn't want to wait. When you become eligible for the boosters, you want to take it because it's important in those high-risk populations to maintain your immunity as high as possible always. You don't want to wait and let your immune system run down and run the risk of getting an infection.
So if we're going to get a new vaccine that focuses on Omicron, what is this pesky thing going to change again? And we're going to see a totally new set of variants? Or is this maybe this could be how we knock it out?
I think we're getting better at inducing the broad immunity that keeps variants from emerging. I'm sure there'll always be variants coming through. I think we'll never eliminate COVID-19 from the human population now that it's been established. But I think that this next generation of bivalent vaccines is sort of showing us this path forward to get good vaccines that are broad in terms of their protection, but also have the potential to protect you for more than just 3 months or 6 months, that may have the potential to protect you for longer periods of time. And so that you can really sort of be, have a higher level of confidence that when you get the vaccine, you'll be protected not only from severe disease, but also from the regular disease, which we know it puts people out for a week, keeps you out of work, does all the things that that are problematic as most infections do.
So would this be a new chance? I mean, if I, let's say I hadn't been vaccinated, someone who hasn't been vaccinated could start in the fall with this new vaccine. Is that correct?
Absolutely.
And maybe this is a new opportunity to remind people how important it is to be vaccinated and to be current on your vaccinations for COVID.
Absolutely. And I think the other thing is, you know, there are a lot of people who got Omicron infections who weren't vaccinated. And it's becoming clear that Omicron by itself doesn't induce a really strong immune response like previous variants did. So even that portion of the population that didn't want to get vaccinated, that got Omicron, those are people that need to be targeted and told, now you need to get the booster to really make sure that you're protected from a reinfection going forward. Because again, Omicron infection by itself isn't going to be enough to protect people from reinfection, certainly for the long term.
And I guess since so many people are getting COVID, even though they've been vaccinated, and as we've established, they are protected from death in most cases. Is that going to hurt vaccination efforts going forward?
And, you know, we struggle with this with seasonal influenza vaccines. All of us in the scientific community want a vaccine that's as good as possible. And, you know, none of us scientists like to say, well, it protects against severe disease, but not from infection, because we realize that that's not what people want. I do feel like we're moving forward now with the realization in the scientific community and the pharmaceutical community that we need to make better vaccines that are more than just protecting from severe disease. And I think this bivalent vaccine that's coming in the fall is a good step in that direction. Scientists and pharmaceutical companies need to do better to try to come up with more effective vaccines against COVID-19. Again, we know it's going to be here and we're not going to get rid of it from the human population. So we really now have to continue our research efforts to make sure that we're improving those vaccines and getting them to a better level of inducing strong and long-term immunity.
Andy Pekosz, thanks so much for joining me.
My pleasure.
Public Health on Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by J.B. Arbogast, Holly Cardinal, Spencer Greer, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media run by Grace Holes Fernandez and Amber Bryan Singletary. Thank you for listening.